Good morning. This is Scott. I am with Serve with Purpose. It is God Talk Go Time. And we are happy to be back with you this week. I have, of course, the one, the only Cody Top Man here. Top Man, not Top Man.
Yeah, as I say, you were close.
Yeah, well, close through what? Mike? Because it wasn't the closest of the word. So, Top Man, it's Cody. Hey, Cody, that's easier. Yeah. How you been, bud?
I've been doing pretty good. Just been having fun at church. Still a little weird not being at going to work right now with my thumb or being able to go out and do softball or volleyball, but been able to spend a lot of time with my wife and family, so I'd say it's definitely a blessing.
Well, that's good. That's I think I go to work with both my thumbs. So yeah, anyway, but I don't work with my thumbs. I mean, I do. Sometimes they need help and sometimes I have to counsel them, so I do work with my thumbs. Anyway, so yeah, so hey guys, we are wanting to talk today about leaving a legacy. It's important. We as families, we see families go. You know, we live for so long, and one of the things that is guaranteed besides taxes is that your life is going to be done. And I think the question I like to lead with is what will they think about you, you know, when you're gone? What's going to be their description? I love these things on these Facebook posts. It says when you think of this, or if you were to say that I should work at this job, or when you hear this of me, what do you say? You know, those kind of things. And it's really odd how many different views that people get, and they're so opposite scale, you know. And I think it's important that we know what we're bringing to the table. It's important to know what we're living, you know, what kind of life we're living. You got small kids.
Well, some of them are small. Some of them are pretty big for being right.
Yeah. Yeah, so when you think of leaving a legacy, what do you think of other than shutting my phone off? Go ahead.
For me, you know, my legacy that I hope to leave when I pass on, or to pass on to my kids, is something that I was actually taught through my mom and dad. Is, you know, is big one is, you know, show people love, and then show them kind and, you know, care and concern. We talk a lot about that during treatment, but, you know, I watched my dad, you know, even when we didn't have a lot growing up, my dad still, you know, he could be as busy as ever, but if someone needed help or needed something, he would take that time to still do it for them, because he genuinely cared about them and wanted to help them. And that was one of the things that I think that I took from my mom and my dad also, that, you know, I hope to pass that down through my kids, because you never know when you're helping that person, you know, what they'll do, you know, to help the next person that's struggling too. You hope to make that ripple effect.
Yeah. And that ripple effect is when the kids see what you do, when they hear you talk, when they watch your compassion. You know, one of the things that I struggle with is my past has been anger, you know, so when my kids see that, how angry I get at times, that always concerns me of how they feel, you know, and what they might go through. And my kids are older. I mean, I've got my son just, I think I was just telling you this earlier, my son went to Disney World today down in Florida, and they went in to get two kids, him and his wife, and they said out of the four of them, two of them had temperatures. So this was their first day. They were going to be there all week, and they wouldn't let them in. In fact, you know, they had to cancel everything. They had to turn around and come back home. That's a long drive to get there, you know. And so, you know, I wonder how he's handling it. You know, I wonder how he's reacting. I wonder if he's able to leave, even though that's probably a pretty heavy event, especially on the kids, that, you know, they have all these expectations and then they have to turn around and come home. I wonder how he's handling that with his kids, you know. And those little things like that are important. It means the world to us, on how our kids live beyond us.
I know, like in that instance, like you just talked about, for me, when I have those type of situations, I try to remove myself from the situation for a second to figure out, you know, once my kid thinks back about this situation, you know, what's his thoughts going to be, you know, how did my dad or how did my parents handle this situation? And if you're able to handle it correctly, or, you know, they might look back when they run into similar situations, because a lot of kids end up, you know, mimicking what their parents did or what their parents taught them.
Yeah.
That, you know, each of those situations is a building block for you to teach your kid how to handle, you know. Unfortunately, we live in a life full of different adversities that, you know, the more building blocks you give your kid to learn, you know, to learn how to deal with those situations, the better off they'll be.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're going to listen to a video. We'll put this Cody did last week. We'll go ahead and put these on the Facebook page. But we're going to listen to a video. It's about 3 minutes long. It's from a YouTube channel called Team Fearless. Very, very good video. I want you guys to listen to this, and then we'll be right back.
I wish I didn't take life so seriously. I wish I didn't take life so seriously. I wish I didn't take life so seriously. I wish I lived more. I wish I gave more happiness to my family. I wish I knew how precious life was, how fleeting, how special, and at the same time fragile and insignificant. I wish I didn't give up on my dreams so easy. One day, life will flash before your eyes. Make sure it's worth watching. When we look back on our life, in our last breaths, we will all wonder, did my life mean anything? Did my life mean anything to this world? Was I loved? Did I have an impact on anyone else's life? Did I matter? We won't be worried about our bills. We won't be worried about our hair. We certainly won't care about our favorite TV show. We won't spare a second thought of others' opinions and judgments. Did I matter? Before you reach that last breath, today might be the time to make a change. Make your life matter. One day, it will be over. There will be two dates, either side of a dash. Make sure that dash is not empty. Make sure it is full of life, full of living. Oscar Wilde once said, "To live is the rarest thing in the world. Most people exist. That is all." And he was right. Don't live like everyone else. Existing. Be extraordinary. Live every moment with passion and wonder. Don't take anything or anyone for granted. What is important to you? What dreams do you have? Go get them. What are you waiting for? You only have one shot. If you miss the target, at least you will live with pride, knowing you have no regrets. Who do you love? Who has loved you? Tell them. Tell them now. You never know when it will be your last chance. Don't take this magical thing called life for granted. Keep your head when everyone else is losing theirs. Trust yourself when everyone else doubts you. Master your dreams when all others give up on theirs. Be the captain when everyone else is content being the crew. Be the lion when all others are playing sheep. Be the leader when all others are following. Live each day as if it may be your last on earth. It may be. Leave your legacy.
Okay, that's That video was meant a lot, especially the one statement that says, one day it will be over. You know, and like we said before, it is. You got to be checking myself, the on-off button there. Like before, we talked about before is, you know, that one thing is for sure is that we are going to pass from this world. It's going to be done. We will move on. And I like it. The video in the beginning of it says, one day it's going to be over. You know, what are we leaving? You know, I've done funerals in the past with people are not of God, and it's hard to do that because you want to stay on track. You want to make sure that people remember, you know, their lives, where they've come from, but you don't want to give anybody false promises. You know, I don't believe that's of God. So I believe that if someone is not living the life they're supposed to be living, then I think we have to use that to help others. So doing a funeral with somebody who's not, you know, has not made that decision is, it's really a difficult one to do. But it teaches me a lot, you know.
And I know when I was younger, you know, I really struggled with knowing that in my heart, like God was calling me to, you know, to talk to family members that I know that was going downhill or sick and not having that conversation with them. You know, do you know Christ? Are you saved? Yeah. Now, luckily, you know, I would talk to my other family members and they would talk to me about how they were saved, but that I don't know if fear, I guess fear would be the, you know, the word or. That,
it's a healthy fear. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm talking about the fear of stepping out of that boundary of, you know, having that conversation when I was younger was really hard for me.
Yeah.
That, you know, now if God's calling me to do it, you know, I'd feel a lot more comfortable doing it, but that's because I've built that building block of, you know, we talked with the boys, the hardest thing to do is to make that first step. Yeah. After the first step, you know, the second one's easier and it gets easier and easier to do. And that can be positive or negative,
yeah,
depending on what you're talking about.
Yeah, it can. And I think that I think one thing I want to do is to make sure that that conversation is had. I know that when my grandfather passed, my father-in-law at the time led him to Christ, you know, on his deathbed. I think deathbed experiences are good. You know, my grandfather left quite a legacy. You know, he was really loved in town. He was known as someone who was going to give the shirt off your back and all this stuff. But all in all, you know, his life, he had not accepted, you know, he had not accepted Christ. And Russell Bishop is his name. My father-in-law, he's passed on. But he actually made a comment to him. He says, what did you just do? And my grandfather pointed to the sky and said, I put him, and then pointed to his heart. And he said, in here. And so that is a pretty good statement by a man on his deathbed. And he knew, you know, it was it. And, you know, so that's kind of a great point to say, you know, he knows what he did. He asked Jesus in his heart.
Yep, and it had a ripple effect. And look at you now.
Yeah. And he is. He was a great man. But his life didn't reflect God. But the fact that he made that decision means he was a smart man.
And I know a lot of the stuff we talk about is treatment. I can tell you that I had a similar situation. My uncle. Here recently, and I think in the past 2 years, passed away. One of the happiest, funniest people you'd ever know in this world. But he always felt like Christianity was, you know, he wouldn't be accepted into it, that it wasn't for people like him. And it wasn't until there was this gentleman that was in a bike gang that had some tattoos that didn't fit your normal, you know, Sunday morning, you know, suit and tie Christian, yeah, that, you know, asked, you know, can I start coming and praying with you? And, you know, that guy kind of opened himself up, was a little vulnerable with my uncle, explained, you know, what what his past was, you know, that he had a checkered past in his background, that, you know, my uncle was able to see, you know, God's not calling just, you know, a person in a tie and a suit that's never had any flaws in the back of his life.
Yeah.
This man was able to help bring my uncle to Christ, you know, 4 or 5 months before he passed away. And, you know, my cousins, you know, they still are struggle with it. They have a lot of anger with God, yeah, with my uncle passing away. But you can see to where if that gentleman didn't come in and, you know, introduce God into my uncle's life, the chances of my cousins having that opportunity to come to Christ would have been a lot harder. Now, you know, that opens up the door that I can talk with my cousins about, you know, there's going to come a day that, you know, you're going to pass away and you have an opportunity to be with your father again.
Yeah.
And that there, you know, this hurt that you're holding on to is not hurt that you need to hold on to, you know. The devil wants to keep you in this feeling, and there's a chance to get through it, you know, and see the love that your father got to have in that, you know, his final couple months of his life, that, you know, he knew he was able to see that if he didn't have Christ, you know, that end, there was no hope at the end, to where, you know, God's love for us and sacrifice he made for us gives us hope.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And that's a good point. You know, we have to have hope. We have to have that. We talked about a couple things on this video. We heard him say, what are the dashes? You know, the dash between the birth date and the date of death on your tombstone. That's your life. That represents the life you lived. You know, what's that dash stand for? And so it is important that somebody, as I'm alive, tell me, hey, this is what your dash is standing for right now. You know, you need to change it, or kudos, keep up. You know, somebody needs to do that. You know, they always say, you tell somebody, hey, man, listen, I tell you, I'm really worried about you. You're just not really doing the same thing. They say, well, God, only God judges. And that's what you need to fear. That's what I'm trying to tell you. There's going to be a judgment day, and God is going to judge you. And when God judges you, it's going to be that final judgment. Don't be wrong on that final judgment. So the thing where people say only God can judge me is such a reckless statement. And I'm telling you, if you've ever said it, I don't mean to make anybody mad, but the fact is to say only God can judge me. That is correct. That is correct. But the Bible clearly says that that he will call us to be pastors and prophets and all these different teachers, all these different titles to help those people. So when God does judge us, then we are judged upon what we've done in our life. And that's leaving a legacy. That's leaving a godly legacy. We pulled up a scripture here, 2 Proverbs 13:22. It says, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children, his children's children. So it helps us to understand that it doesn't end with our kids, you know. One thing I love in life is on, you know, Thanksgiving. I love my son brought my granddaughter, one of my granddaughters down to visit a couple weeks ago. And you know, but one thing I truly enjoy more than almost anything in life is my grandchildren. You know, it's my children's children, you know. So I want them to see me and know who I am. I want them to know what I live for and what I stand for. And, you know, a lot of people listen to these don't have grandchildren. Some people don't that are listening to this don't have kids, you know. But, you know, there's going to come a point where that's going to happen. If God allows you to be here that long. I love Steve Harvey said last week, you know, when God wakes you up, it means you're not done. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I love that. And I've thought about that almost every single day. You know, well, guess God's not done with me. You know, so. But yeah, so I think that we have to be able to live that life knowing that it's inheritance, not just for my kids, but my children's children, and not just them. It's everyone else's kids. It's everyone else that sees me on the road. You know, do I get angry when I'm on the road and flip people off and honk the horn and cut them off? You know, Yeah. Okay. So I do. No, I'm kidding. So, you know, so, but I do get upset, you know, and when I'm driving, I do have these issues that I struggle with. But I think that this title helps us to understand how we can always be better.
Yep. I know out at Mohegan, and it was a crazy statistic. I think it was close to like 90% of the people that we had there, the young kids, the one thing they all had in common, it didn't matter where they were from, you know, what color their skin was, the most thing they all had in common was the fact that most of them were raised in fatherless homes.
Yeah.
That they didn't have that person in their life showing them, you know, the right morals and values, that, you know, that person missed the opportunity to leave that legacy with their kids. Then you would have some families that, you know, you would be able to look at. I had one kid, I'm not going to name who it was, but you could go back and look in four generations of his, I think it was like three or four generations of his, all struggled with using meth. And you could see how it started with, you know, the parent, and it was normalized and it was okay in that household that, you know, their kid didn't see that as a problem. And it trickled down three generations, that it wasn't until, you know, we got that kid in and he worked with us that we were able to help him see, you know, this isn't okay, this, you know, and show him these are the effects of using drugs, what it has in your life. You know, he can look at his family and say, you know, the struggles they're having is because of the drug use. And you see that throughout the Bible. I mean, in the Old Testaments, you see to where, you know, God gave the people these set of rules, you know, the Ten Commandments to follow, and how it started off, you know, one of the children decided to start worshiping, you know, false idols.
Yeah.
And how the kid after him tended to struggle with that problem, and how it trickled down until one of the kids would step up and say, you know, hey, this is wrong. And they would start, you know, they would start working with God and start, you know, God would start helping him process through, you know, the errors of what was happening. But the fact of how the parent before him, even though that kid changed his ways, a lot of times the kid right after him, you know, still fell into his past family's issues. Because, I mean, if you have a grandparent that still had those ways, you know, and it's still in the world, that it's still easy to fall back into those same negativity because it's still normalized around you. Yeah. That it's important that once you work through that problem, that you try to help the people around you work through the problem too, so that it's not normalized in a family, like culture or, you know, in your morals or value system.
Yeah, I'm very good. We do have to make that. Somewhere in that line, we got to help people to make that change. There was a I want to kind of wrap this up, if you don't mind, to talk about a young man that came from the big city to a small town that lived a life of, you know, would, you know, did a lot of stuff. Let's just go through there. That young man was me. Apparently, I just gave that away, didn't I? But I came to a small town and I met this guy. He was a sports announcer. I played football. His sports announcer, his name was Bob Bostic. He passed away a few months back. But he reached out and he helped me to live that legacy, to stop that family tree that was going downhill consistently, down and down and down. And because of that, doesn't mean I didn't have struggles, because I did have struggles after that. You know, I went to the military. I used, I drank. I had a hard time. But, you know, because of his love, because of his reaching out, stating, I don't care where you come from. I want to be here. I want to reach out to you. And I was a goofy kid, just like him today, you know. I liked to joke around. I was very sarcastic, not as sarcastic as I am now. I've improved that skill.
Does that mean you got better at doing it?
I got better at being sarcastic. That's true. In the military, when I went through drill academy, one thing they teach you to do is be sarcastic. You'll learn that very well. But, But we have to learn, you know, that when we step out and we reach out to people, then we're doing exactly what it talks about in the Old Testament. I mean, look at David. David made a huge error. King David, he lusts, he murdered, he stole, he committed adultery. Adultery. I think I just made up a word.
We knew where you were going.
That's a first. But he really struggled. And look at Paul. Paul was Saul. Saul, you read about Saul in chapter 9 of Romans. It talks about Saul's change when Saul was changed, he murdered Christians. He went out and he exacted warrants out. You know, he put the warrants out and he arrested Christians, and he was a man of the law. That's what he did, and he had been blinded and by God, and God had to talk to him, and he said, "This is where I want you to go," and he sent him to another Christian. Remember that one? That go to Straight Street. And he was like, "Wait a minute, God, what are you doing here? You're sending this guy."
Could you imagine being the Christian that this guy that you know has been sent out there to find your group?
Yeah. That is scary. But Saul turned out to be Paul. He was renamed, and he turned out to be the writer of most of the Bible, most of the New Testament. And he did most of that in prison. And you look at that and you see how his attitude was and how his love still was. It was all still intact while he was in prison. But he became a man of God. Those kind of people go to heaven. People don't understand. They say, "Well, look at all the bad things I've done. How can God love me?" You haven't done anything compared to what a lot of people have done. You know, we see all these serial killers, and I'm not going to try to remember them. I know of a couple of them, and I don't want to be wrong, like I am most of the time. I don't want to be wrong in this, but serial killers, they receive Christ on death row, and you hear about it. You've heard about it a couple of times. You hear about a couple of the very popular ones that have big names, but people say he should not go to heaven. Thank God those people are not my judge. I'm not a serial killer. I mean, I love cereal. I would never hurt cereal. But the point is that how can people judge a person when they come to Christ?
The cost of sin is death. And so, yeah. I mean, sin is sin.
Sin is sin. It doesn't matter what that sin is. All sin is equal. And as hard as that is to understand, it's even hard for me to understand. But the Bible says that I believe it. So that's how it is.
Luckily, God loved us enough that, you know, he's already paid the price of our sins, that when you bury it on the cross, that you don't have to keep it anymore. You're reborn. You're a new person. Your past is your past. You leave it there, and that's perfect opening for your weekly scripture about leaving the past in the past and staying focused on the forward.
Philippians 3:13 says, look forward. Forget the past. Reach forward for that goal. We do that so much, and I think this is probably the title of my life, because it seems like I'm always bringing this up to people. If you allow yourself to look behind, it doesn't matter if you were Saul, Paul, it doesn't matter if you were David. If he looked at all those sins he did and said, I'm helpless, this is it. I mean, what would that have done to the bloodline of Jesus? Because, the Old Testament brings out the bloodline of Jesus. That's what it does from the creation in Genesis all the way through, and it brings out the bloodline of Jesus, and Jesus is born through that. Mary has that bloodline from the very beginning, from the creation, and that's what the Bible, Old Testament, follows, is that bloodline include the.
It's a fulfillment David. Of God's promise.
It's a fulfillment of God's promise, absolutely. So we have to know how blessed we are. The people didn't look at their past. They didn't wear the labels of the things they did. I mean, look at my goodness. Look at Peter. And what a screw up. I mean, you know what I'm saying? He just couldn't keep. He could not. He was his own worst enemy. But you know, God loved him, and he named him the Rock because what he believed in was solid. So listeners, if you're out there and you have this belief that you feel, man, this is the way it is, I tell you, bam, 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 man, you are a jewel to God. Because, you know, if you do that for Christ, you are another Billy Graham. You know, you're another any of these other awesome ministers out there. You know, you could be anything you want to be and bring people into Christ. If you lead one person to Christ, you have saved somebody's eternal life.
You always talk to the boys about, you know, how our life in the grand scheme of, you know, the timeline is a speck.
Yeah.
And that was one thing I always used to, I don't know if we got time for you to go into it on there, but like I said, it was really eye-opening for the boys that you would talk to them about it.
Absolutely. And basically what Cody's talking about is how our life here on earth is just a moment. It's a speck of time from eternity. It's nothing. It's no time at all. In fact, I explained to the boys it's like life, then there's eternity. Then there's eternity. You know, you have life, then there's eternity. It's then eternity, you know? So everybody lives like that, and it's eternity, and it's on and on and on. Go to eternity and hold up your hand. You can't, because it's eternity. You can't, because that's the end, right? There's no end to eternity. So what we do on earth, we are going to be rewarded in eternity. Whether it's rewarded with negative, you know, there's going to be two doors that we're going to go through. It's not going to be, what is that? Let's make a deal. There ain't no deal be made then. The deal's made right now. Let's make that deal now. And that is, how do I want this, you know, life to be? I should quit spitting all over my table, should I? You know, but how do we want life to be? We want life to be meaningful. We want that life, or as the speaker said in this in the Team Fearless video, we want that dash to be awesome, because that's all it is. We are just a dash from eternity. We began eternity. That's it. You know, how was your life? Well, let me explain it to you. That was it. You know, it was that. That was it.
And God loved us enough that he was willing to give us the opportunity, that the only thing we have to pay for eternity is to believe that Jesus is our Savior and be loved. I mean, what kind of price is that to pay?
Yeah, and let me give a message also. Let me give a message to those people who say, why should we pay for what Adam and Eve did? That is exactly what this message is about, the legacy. We have to break that legacy. Yeah, but all these other people broke it. Why should we pay and go through all this pain because of Adam and Eve? You can blame the woman if you want, but, you know, I'm not going to today.
Good choice.
Yeah, but this is the message. The message is this, is that every day you make a decision, and you've got to think about the things that you've done to affect other people's lives. You know, when you throw a pebble in a pond, that pond's going to ripple until there's no more water left. There's no more a ripple that can be made. That's how much of an effect you make on life. And what we don't understand is we want to be the victim of what, you know, what we have to pay. I've been to jail, I can tell you. There's not too many people in jail that did the crime they did. Ask them, they'll tell you. I'm innocent, you know. And so we can't be innocent from this. We are born in sin. That's just the way it is. And the thing is, it makes it feel like we have to go build somebody's mansion by hand in a 2 foot of snow, barefooted, you know, on a lean, you know, and we got to think, oh my gosh, this is so hard. Why do we have to go through all this hardness because of an Adam and Eve? It's just one simple decision, you know. One simple decision. Do you believe that Christ died on a cross for you? It's a simple decision. It could have been harder. It could have been a lot harder, right? We could have been paying for our sins. But Jesus came down and paid a debt he didn't own. He did not own that debt. And we had a debt we don't even have to pay. We can't pay that debt.
Yeah, to say we weren't able to pay.
Yeah, so that's why Jesus came on the cross. So we have to stop being a victim, a spiritual victim of circumstances, thinking that, you know, we this whole God thing is not right, because if a loving God was so loving, then why is we got to stop that, because it doesn't matter. We could never understand why God does the things he does. It doesn't matter what we believe or where we stand. The fact that we need to remember is that God is God of all gods, and he gives us the opportunity. He loves us that much that he gave us a decision. So all you guys without sin, you can go and say that. I've not sinned ever in my life. I'm 58 years old. I'm confused as why I have to come to Christ and ask for forgiveness for something I didn't do. That is ridiculous.
Yep, and you're a prime example of, you know, if when your time that you were wrongly put in, you know, in jail, if you took that time and just wallowed into, you know, why did God do this to me? Luckily, God gave you a heart to help people.
That's right.
And that's what you did during that time, that, you know, in his glory, you were able to touch other people and bring other people to Christ. So that was the reason you were put in that situation, was so that you could save people.
Of the attitude statement, my favorite is, life is 10% of what happens and 90% how you react to it. And I tell you what, I didn't even know that statement when I was in jail. And I tell you, if I could have wallowed in it, you're right. I could have been in fights. I should have probably been beat down, or as they say, beat the brakes off of me, or beat me out the frame, whatever words they had down there. But, you know, 8.5 months I took, and I said, you know, God, you brought me here for a reason. There is a reason we are here. And the legacy, the reason is the legacy. We are to leave a legacy for those people behind us, those ones who are bringing up the rear of this battle that we're in. Those people are bringing up the rear, need to know how we fought the fight. And I tell you, we're going to fight the good fight. That's what I'm going to do. And that's what this podcast is about, fighting a good fight. You know, my mom's in the hospital. She had some touch and go stuff going on. She's getting blood transfusions. And I tell you, it's been killer to me. It has been totally a killer. You know, my mom has lived with us for years. And I tell you, one of the things that really is hurtful to me is, you know, have I spent enough time? Have I, you know, all these things that, you know, and I don't think it's the end yet, but I just know that it really brings you into where do we need to be in our life? Where do we need to be in our life? I don't want this to be so lengthy that people stop listening to us, but I want this. This is such a passion for me, you know, and, you know, if somebody come up here and they said, hey, I was saved yesterday, I want to talk to you about leaving a legacy, I think it's awesome. But to have someone come and say, listen, I'm living a legacy, I'm doing these things, we have a reason. You know, you kids out there that listen to this podcast that was in Mohican with us, you know, I want to tell you, first of all, we love you. Yeah. We would not do this if we didn't care. This would not be part of our lives, our weekly lives. And it's not just weekly. It's more than weekly. You know, we wouldn't do this if we didn't love you guys. If I didn't love those people in my life that I went to school with, that were in my youth groups, that, you know, that were just part of my past. If I didn't love them, some of these people have seen me at my worst, you know, but I could take that and go, oh my gosh, I'm going to live that past. It's so embarrassing. I can't do a podcast, and then miss the opportunity to reach this one person. You know what? If we have one listener, which I think we got 2.5 because one's really short. No, but if we just had one listener and one listener receives something out of this, then we have done God's will. We should have two, because there are two of us, because we have one and one apiece, right?
Yeah, I'm assuming you're the short one, because I think I might be taller than you.
I was going to say.
Is the half long. Maybe that's half long? That's what
it is. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, the half long. That's it. So, but guys, I hope we didn't ramble on. But you know what? We're not going to edit it. We're going to keep it the way it is. Guys, we love you very much. We care about what happens. I want to leave I'm going to leave you guys with a song by Matthew West. I played this in group Saturday, and I had a hard time. I couldn't even put my camera on. I had Kleenex in my eyes, and now I was like, hey, I'm a little too good, guys. We're back from break. You know, I'm like an artard over here. But, you know, but I just – this is such a very good song that can really reach out to so many people. And I want you to listen to this, because this is very important. But, you know, we're going to leave. We're going to go ahead and end on that. Do you have anything else you want to say?
Just the only thing that comes to mind is, you know, God tells us that You know, his blessings go from, you know, up to the third generation of our kids, and those blessings could be positive or negative, and it's up to us to determine what blessings we're leaving our kids.
Yeah. You know, some places, in fact, the Bible talks about this, and I don't study this much. I like to take responsibility, but some believers believe, and it may be true, that your family will, their destiny or their decision for Christ is based on what happens with you, that you make those decisions, and then that reflects on your family, and by your decisions and your action in life is how your family's judgment will be. I don't know how I feel. I don't know. I think we should take kids, obviously. Kids don't have a responsibility. I believe that God loves his children very much. He shows that. But at the same time, you know, imagine if we were responsible for somebody else, and we're bringing somebody else into eternity. Do we want them to live forever in peace and in joy and in no pain, no sorrow, no sadness, in what the Bible explains to be the most wonderful experience ever? We can't even
for
imagine.
Eternity.
For eternity. And that's until, forever. Yeah. You know, or do we want to lead them into the pit of hell? You know, and we don't even need to go into all that, what happens there, but go ahead.
And, you know, if you view it as a risk that you're taking, whether it's true or not, I would argue that your kids are worth the chance of it making the difference of that.
If you're doubting whether God is real, what if you're wrong?
I can tell you, if I'm wrong, I know I lived a life loving for people and caring for people. So it was a life worth living.
That's right. Well, amen, brother. Appreciate it. Man, I appreciate you, Cody. You've been an awesome friend. And, you know, I'm really looking forward to seeing where our future goes with this.
Yes, sir.
I love doing this. Sometimes I'm so tired. Sometimes my head just goes different places because I struggle. I know it's hard to believe. I know. Settle down, guys. Settle down. It's okay. I do struggle. You know, but when I get on this, I just know that God is leading us in the right spot. And guys, I really want to challenge you guys. If you guys that are listeners, man, just drop in a thumbs up or something in the Facebook page. Go to our email. We'd love to listen. We'd like to hear from you. We've heard some from a couple people, and I just want to shout out to those guys who reach out and are just being blessed by this podcast. But you know, we are serving with purpose. You know, we're not serving to be serving. We're serving with purpose. We are living on purpose. And that's important to understand, to live on purpose. Yeah. Guys, we are going to leave you with this. And first of all, I just want to say, if you do want to get a hold of us, please do. Do it by the email. Email is servewithpurpose3@gmail.com. That's servewithpurpose, the number 3@gmail.com. Reach out to us there. And Cody, what is a Facebook? Can you explain how we do the Facebook?
The Facebook is, it's a Facebook group on there. You can look us up on there. It's Served with Purpose. Anytime that we list a video or like a song on there, you know, we're going to start listing the actual videos on there. Because I know me personally, I'm more of a visual person.
Yeah.
That, you know, we're going to list actually a video on there that actually wasn't on the podcast that, you know, it's powerful and it speaks to you.
Yeah.
And, you know, it strikes different emotions out of you, you know, that if that helps touch you or speak to you, you know, we want to list those because, you know, if it helps you, then that's what we're trying to do.
Yeah. You know, and we're looking at a couple other things too. Probably should have told you this before. I like to make this a YouTube and start coming on and being video. And if you guys would like to see this podcast go video and just go on YouTube, let us know. We would like to know. Because we got an easy setup here to do it. I would love to be able to sit down and have a YouTube channel and have this podcast be YouTube as well. So if you guys are, now you can't find us on YouTube. You can find us YouTube, Spotify, Apple, and obviously Podbean. So make sure you guys go to podbean.com, look up the Serve with Purpose podcast. You have to do all that. because I did not do it right. It's the Serve with Purpose podcast on Podbean.
Well, part of that's a good problem, though. I mean, the issue is there's a lot of Christian-based podcasts out there, but that's a good problem to have, not a bad problem.
Yeah, yeah, it is. That is. So guys, thanks for coming out. Thanks again for being out here. And I think we're going to go check out the Quest, too, right, when we're done?
Yep, sounds fun to me. Yeah. Yeah. So we love you, and we hope you enjoyed, what was it, Matthew West, Leave a Legacy.
Matthew, Family Tree is what Family it's called. Family Tree. Yeah, so we're going to leave you with this song. Again, like he said, it's a song by Matthew West, Family Tree. Guys, we love you. God bless. Have a wonderful day.
Nobody ever would. Caught in the middle of this dysfunction. It's your sad reality. It's your messed up family tree. And now you're left with all these questions. Are you gonna be like your father was and his father was? Do you have to carry what they've handed down? Your destiny, yesterday does not define you. No, this is not your legacy. This is not your misery. I can break the chains that bind you. Spring, you're bringing new life to your family tree.